This is what you want to do, right? This is where you're headed. Show of hands, who wants to do this? Y'all are crazy. This is, of course, what they call a bee beard. This is kind of a gimmick thing. Does anybody know how they do this? They take a queen bee and they put her in a little wooden cage, and they usually tie it underneath his chin, and then they'll dump out a bunch of bees from a hive, and they are attracted to the smell, the odor of that queen bee, and they land all over you. And so it looks like you're wearing a beard of bees. And that's not a way to get a lot of hugs, but it certainly does impress people, but you know, not necessarily for the right reasons. But if you want to be a beekeeper, you're not alone. Obviously, there's a lot of people here that want to get started in beekeeping. And I've been teaching this class now for about a dozen years. We had to take off recently for COVID, but we've been doing this a long time. And every year we've got a new crop of beekeepers. It's a very popular hobby and everybody seems to want to get into it, but it is work. You know, it's like gardening. It's a labor of love. It's a lot easier to go to the grocery store and buy a tomato than to grow them. But that homegrown tomato is going to taste a lot better than anything you can buy at the store this time of year, right? It's the same with honey. Once you've tasted your own fresh honey from your own backyard, you can't go back to that store-bought stuff. So there's a lot easier ways to get honey, but all that work just makes it a little bit sweeter. It is expensive to get started, so don't get sticker shock. But most of the costs for beekeeping are on the front end, and if you take care of that equipment, it's going to last you a long time. If you take care of your bees, they'll stay healthy. They should last a while too. There's a fairly steep learning curve, which is why this class is broken up into three sessions, because if I tried to teach it all in one day, we'd all die of exhaustion. And it does require some commitment. A lot of people are under the impression that you can just buy a wooden box and dump a bunch of bugs in it, and then nature takes care of everything else. It used to be that way, but it's a lot harder now. It's a lot more challenging to keep bees, and you're definitely going to have to put a little bit of time and effort into this. But the time is now. This is the perfect time for you guys to be taking this class and getting started, because early spring is the best time to start up a brand new beehive. They are in high demand. They're also in short supply, because coming out of the winter, a lot of beekeepers have lost colonies that they want to replace, or they may have just lost queen bees, so they want to buy new queens to put in there. And so the later it gets in the season, then the harder it is to be able to even find bees for sale. I gave you guys a handout. You should have picked one up outside. And the back page has a number of places here locally in other parts of Arkansas where you could get some honeybees. So we'll talk about that in a little bit. But a lot of producers sell out in the early spring because there is high demand. So if you want to get those bees, then you need to get your name on a list early, usually. So that means starting in January or so, you want to reserve. Sometimes you have to put down a deposit. If you don't, you can still get them, but they may not arrive until May or sometimes even into June, and you're going to miss out on the early spring flowers. They're going to help your bee colonies grow up and really build their populations. So, of course, don't forget to get your beehives and other equipment that we're going to talk about tonight, so you can get it all ready, get it painted, put it all together, so that when your bees do arrive, they're not homeless. You've got a place to put them. Beekeeping in these nice little white boxes you sometimes see on the side of a road or on a farm. This is relatively new in our relationship with the honeybees. We've been using this type of hive for about 150 years or so, but we have been keeping bees for thousands of years in lots of different ways. You know, back when people lived in caves and they clubbed their dinner over the head with a big stick, honeybees were already organized in a very complex society. They looked out for each other. They would hunt and gather all of their own resources. At some point, somebody saw something like this and said, I'm going to stick my hand in there and I'm going to eat whatever I find. No telling what they were thinking, but I guess I'm glad that they did, because of course that started our wonderful association with the honeybee. Somebody found that honey was delicious stuff. There's still places in the world where people do hunt wild beehives and they chop open trees and they take the honey out that way, but there are much easier ways to do it. We have cave paintings and rock art and things like that all over the world depicting different ways where people are collecting honey. This one over here on the left side, it's supposed to be over 6,000 years old. This is from a cave in Spain. It's supposed to show someone gathering honey on the side of a cliff surrounded by honeybees. This guy is in Nepal. He's still doing this same method today. He's dangling over the side of a cliff, no bee suit, no smoke, trying to knock a honeycomb off the rock into a basket while hanging on to a homemade ladder. There's easier ways to do this. The Egyptians were probably the first people that really figured out how to do it. They noticed that if they left a piece of pottery outside or a basket or something like that, that a swarm of bees would naturally nest inside of it. If they couldn't find a hollow tree, they looked for some other kind of cavity. And so they created beehives that were kind of long cylindrical terracotta pipes, or sometimes they would use hollow logs. And the ancient Egyptian ruins have lots of illustrations of farming and everyday life, and there's a lot of scenes that depict beekeeping. And they knew what time of year they could go in and they could blow smoke in there and drive the bees out and cut out all those honeycombs and harvest the honey. So they were the first ones to really kind of figure that out. And in the Middle East and in different places, a lot of them still use this same type of beehive today. All the ancient peoples kept bees in some way or other, or took advantage of them. And so you see honeybees depicted in lots of different art and jewelry and on coins. They knew a fair amount about beekeeping and honeybees. Aristotle actually wrote a whole treatise on beekeeping, but he had a lot of strange ideas as well that, of course, we realize now are wrong. One of the things that ancient people believed was that if you bury an ox in the ground up to its neck, a dead ox, I don't think you do it with a live one, then a swarm of bees would issue from it. Well, if you leave a dead cow laying around, you are going to get a lot of insects, but you're not going to get a lot of honey from them. But for some reason, that got written down, and people believed it for a long time. Another piece of ancient lore was the idea that if you do see a swarm of bees, you take out your big metal kitchen pan and a big metal spoon, and you bang them together, and it will call the bee swarm down, and they'll land somewhere where you can collect them. And a lot of people actually believed this until quite recently, and some of y'all may have heard of this from your grandparents. People would practice this. It was called tanging. And so it's depicted in a lot of illustrations in ancient beekeeping literature. The truth is, it doesn't really matter if you're banging on your pots and pans. Honeybees don't travel very far when they leave their hive before they settle down anyway. And we'll talk about that swarming behavior later. But if you run out into the street banging your kitchenware together, essentially what you've done is call attention to it, and you've called dibs on that swarm that you saw, because you couldn't just call on the phone with your credit card and order bees to be sent to you in the mail back then. The only way to get more bees usually was to capture a swarm, so that was a good way to do it. What people did know about bees is that they needed shelter. Honeybees like to live in hollow trees or some other cavity, and so we can provide them with some kind of shelter, and we can make them reasonably happy, and they can produce honey for us. We know that bees visit flowers because that's where you see them all, and we know that bees need fresh water because you'll also see them, especially in hot weather, down by the creek, lapping up a little bit of water and taking it home with them. And of course, it's a good idea to keep the honeybees away from livestock, or actually to keep your livestock away from the honeybees. Cows aren't very smart. If they're in the same pasture with beehives, sometimes they'll rub up against them and just knock them over and not realize why they're being stung. Horses also get stung, but they're a little smarter and they hold a grudge. Several people have told me that their horses have kicked over their beehives when they got stung. And when you set the hives back up, you leave them in the same pasture, the horses come back and kick them over again because they remember that those beehives were so mean. So you want to make sure that you keep them out of the way. If you've got chickens or other poultry, you can actually keep them in the same yard with honeybees, and they do very well together. Your hens will actually eat some of the other insects that like to get into beehives. We can talk about that later on in our lessons. So people didn't necessarily know a whole lot about beekeeping or about honeybee biology and things, but they knew enough to get by. In Europe, honeybees were just another wild species, and if you just left one of these straw baskets upside down, then bees would naturally nest inside of it. Sometimes they would keep bees in the trees. You'd find a wild bee's nest. It was not uncommon in some places to just chop open the tree, remove some of the honeycombs, or all of them, depending on what you wanted to do, and you might even take a plank of wood and tie it back shut. If you didn't take all the honey, the bees survive. You can come back next year. You just mark that tree and you know where it is. You can come and get a little bit more. Or if trees fell down, you could take a whole section, you could chop them down, drag it back to the farm, and you could keep the bees inside of those. It was common to carve them into different fanciful shapes as well. This gentleman is in Russia. He's showing off a tree with a mark that his grandfather made. And so he and his son are still keeping bees in this same tree. They go through the forest, they know where all the trees are and exactly what time of year, and he can climb up there and take a couple of honeycombs from each one, and it's plenty for him and his family. So that's some sustainable beekeeping there. For much of Europe, this was the classic beehive we call a skep. It's a straw basket turned upside down, and oftentimes they might have put a little hole in it, or you simply put a rock under one corner and prop it up, and the bees can go up underneath it. A lot easier to carry these around than hollow logs or terracotta pots, so this became a very popular way to keep bees in a lot of places. They often kept bees up on castle walls so the bees could fly out into the countryside and gather nectar and make honey. And if your castle is under siege by some invaders, you can simply push the hives off and drop them on people's heads. So they were used as defense very often as well. Skeps were basically just straw baskets turned upside down, like I said, but they would often weave some sticks into it, and it provided a little bit of support when the bees started to make their honeycomb. But basket making was a common skill, and so these were very easy to make. And at the end of the year, you would just come along, at the end of the summer, you'd pick one up. If it was nice and heavy, then you could harvest the honey from it by holding it over a sulfur fire and killing all the bees. So you punish the bees that did all the hard work by killing them. If it was kind of light, those bees were lazy, they didn't do much, weren't very productive, then you'd let them last another year. But there always seemed to be plenty of bees, so they would just put the empty skeps out again next year, and more swarms would move in. Now, when people came over here to the New World, the colonists brought lots of their favorite plants and animals with them. There were no honeybees in North and South America. They're not native to this side of the world. And so they brought them from Europe, and the honeybees thought it was great over here. There was lots of old growth forest on the East Coast, lots of hollow trees, plenty of wildflowers, and there wasn't a lot of competition from the native bees. There are lots of bees that are native. There's about 4,000 species of bees native to North America. We've got over 200 or 300 here just in Arkansas. But they didn't live in large colonies. They didn't make lots of honey like the honeybees. So the honeybees, of course, became very popular. And we didn't have a lot of straw over here. We didn't have vast fields of grain like they did in Europe, where they had cut down a lot of forest, but we had plenty of wood. And so we started keeping bees in box hives like this, or in hollow log hives here in the New World. And so this was very common until fairly recently in a lot of places. But no matter where the bees are, no matter what they're living inside of, they tend to behave in the same way. And they like to build their honeycombs parallel to each other with a little bit of space in between, starting in the top of a cavity and working down. So the longer they live in there, then the longer those honeycombs become. So inside of a hollow tree, sometimes it may not be a space that's very big around, but the honeycombs could be 6, 7, 8 feet tall, all up inside of that hollow tree. Sometimes they show up in surprising places where we don't expect them. So it's very important, if you're an urban beekeeper, to be conscientious of your neighbors, do your best to manage and control for swarms so that they don't get out and try to move into your neighbor's structures or other strange places. But you know, we kept bees for thousands of years before somebody realized that, hey, wait a minute, these combs are always about the same thickness. They're about an inch thick. And they always leave a little bit of space in between them, no matter where they build them. And so this became a revolutionary concept when it was really understood. We call this the bee space. And it's probably the most important concept for you as a beekeeper. So if you're taking notes, write that down, underline it, put some little stars around it, circle it a couple times. That concept makes everything work. And when we violate the bee space, it makes everything go wrong. And I'll come back to that concept again and again as we're working. But it's not one exact measurement. It's kind of a range between about 1/4 inch and 3/8 of an inch. But generally, we consider 3/8 of an inch to be the bee space. It's enough room for two honeybees to work back to back on different honeycombs and not get in each other's way, but be able to move freely around. any space inside of a hive that is larger than 3/8 of an inch, the honeybees are going to build comb in there. So if you have any gaps, any spaces, the bees are going to utilize that by constructing honeycomb, either to store food or to make cells that the queen can use to lay eggs. So that's what they store in these spaces. If there's any space smaller than, and this is what happens if you have too much space. They build combs in weird places. So if you leave an extra amount of space in there, then it causes problems. Any space that's smaller than 1/4 inch, honeybees don't like. They can't use it. And it's a place for other species of insects and pests to get in, to hide, and cause mischief. And so they seal it off. Bees go out and they gather this material called propolis or propolis. It's a resin that they collect from trees, and they kind of use it like caulking. They seal up cracks and crevices in the hive. So when we stack 2 beehive boxes together, they always seal up any gaps in between there with this propolis. It's really sticky and gooey, and sometimes you hear it called bee glue. And sometimes it can stick the hive together so hard it's almost impossible to open them up. It will get on everything you own as a beekeeper if you're not careful. In fact, I was out at my hives this weekend and I took a picture of something, and later I discovered that I had propolis all over my cell phone. So gotta be careful with that. But it gets on your clothes, it gets on your gloves, on your tools, and everything else. And it's really hard to get off. Bees also coat everything inside the hive with a paper thin layer of this propolis. They smear it around anything that shouldn't move, but does, the bees seal it in place. Any space in there that's smaller than 1/4 inch, the bees just fill it in. And if we design and build our hives in the right way, we keep that gap to just the right amount, then the bees don't fill it in. They use it to travel between parts of the hive. They don't build comb there, and they don't fill it with propolis. And so this bee space, proper use of the bee space, is what makes everything work in our modern beehives. It's the basis for what we call the movable frame hive. It is against the law to keep honeybees in any type of hive that you can't remove and inspect the honeycombs. So no more straw skeps, no more log hives. You have to be able to take those combs out and be able to inspect and see what the bees are doing. That doesn't mean you're breaking the law if you have a bee tree on your property, but you're not allowed to maintain bees for honey and things like that if you can't have access to those frames. But this allows us to take one honeycomb out, inspect it, look at it, see what the bees are doing, assess them for health, make sure that the bees have enough room to produce more honey and things like that. We can look and see if the honey is ready to harvest. We'll cover all of this in more detail later, but we can do this without having to destroy everything the bees have made. In the old days, you couldn't do that. Once you got into a beehive, you tore everything up and the bees had to rebuild it all from scratch. So we can rearrange the combs. You can put them in different parts of the hive. You can raise them, you can lower them. You can encourage the bees to work in different parts of the hive without disturbing them all. And when bees get disturbed, of course, they get a little frustrated with us. And so that's when you might get stung. But think about it from their point of view. If somebody took the roof off of your house and started moving all your stuff around, you might get a little irritated with that as well, especially some really huge giant. So from the bees' point of view, we are invaders, we are disturbing them, and they're going to treat us as such.